Alhamdulillah. All praises are due to Allah, the Creator, the Cherisher, and the Sustainer of this universe. And may His peace and blessings be upon His noble prophets, Muhammad, Jesus, son of Mary, Moses, Abraham, Noah, and all of them, and all their followers and descendants. Dear respected brothers and sisters, number one, I have to apologize for two things. Number one, for not coming last week. And actually, I didn't come not because I'm careless. Actually, the guys here should have told you that I was stuck with a faulty plane in Belgium. And they had to disembark all the passengers, and I had to leave the plane. Actually, what happened is amazing. Because it was Friday the 13th. As soon as we boarded the plane, the lights started to go on and off, on and off, on and off like that, crazy, for about 15 minutes. And then it was fixed. Then the plane started to move backward on the runway. While moving backward, the two landing tires were broken. And then they said that, unfortunately, we cannot leave tonight, and you will be either routed to other countries or staying in a hotel. And people start to go, oh, this is Friday the 13th. Yeah, it's an omen, Friday the 13th. I said, look here. It's true that it's bad that we can't make it to London today. But at the same time, had these two landing tires not broken now, they could have been broken when we are landing in Heathrow. Is it still Friday the 13th? And this is my advice to you. There are two types of eyes. The eye of the fly and the eye of the bee. Both of them are flying next to each other, the fly and the bee. The bee sees the flowers and it lands on them and smells them. The fly sees the dirty stuff, the crap. It lands on it and it smells it. And both are there in this world, and they will always be there, flowers and crap. If you have the eye of the fly, you will live a very hard life. If you have the eye of the bee, you will live a beautiful life. And it's the same life. And both are there. So you need to understand that as Muslims, being optimistic is not an option. It's a fard. It's an obligation to be optimistic. How? What is the dalil? I told you before, I like questions to be at the end. But you can always interrupt me with one question. What's your dalil? What's your evidence? How can optimism be a fard? The Quran says in Surah Yusuf, فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Only the kuffar despair from the mercy of Allah. So as long as Allah exists, as long as we will be optimistic. That's it. So this is something very important. The second thing that I want to apologize about is how I'm dressed today, in a jeans. Actually, I'm moving from one house to the other, and I discovered just half an hour ago that all the clothes are in the bags, and I can't get something ironed now quickly, so I had to come with a jeans, so please forgive me for that, but at least I wear a kufi today, so I'm not 100% disqualified. Brother Abd Hakim upstairs is making dua that I don't forget this announcement for Meadows of Paradise. Meadows of Paradise is announcing that tomorrow there is a halaqa in LMC first floor at 6:50 p.m., which means at the time of Asr. I don't know how. Of course, after Asr. It is called Preparing the Heart for Ramadan by Sheikh Abdul Hadi Arwani. Nice. Thank you. Now let's start. Today we have the fifth session. The fifth session in the spiritual purification workshop. If we don't finish this workshop before Ramadan, we will continue after Ramadan, inshallah. This session is called Riyadatul Nafs. Riyada in Arabic means sports. But But at the same time, it means at-tarweed, which is domestication. When you have a wild animal, like a wild horse, that no one went on its back before, it never allows anyone on its back. It keeps jumping, and you need to do domestication in order to make it domestic. So how to domesticate your own soul? Tarweed al-nafs. But in other terms, you can also call it spiritual jihad. You know, jihad is of three types. There is the combative jihad, which people know as jihad, which is fighting to establish justice. And this is a supreme goal in every civilization, not only in the Islamic civilization. And there is verbal jihad, which is to say the truth, even if it goes against your own interests. And there is spiritual jihad. And this session is about the spiritual jihad. How to discipline your own self. How to discipline your own soul. But before that, we talked about a homework last time. Homework last time was to read the Quran, especially the two surahs, Al-Isra and Yunus, and figure out the Al-Ayat al-Tarbawiyyah, the verses that are disciplining the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and us at the same time spiritually. Who did the homework? Show me your hands. Who did it? One, two, three. Who else? Four, alhamdulillah. I think I'm counting for the second time, but it's good, alhamdulillah. Anyway, that's not very good, by the way. Did you bring the ayat with you? You brought it? Can you please bring it? Huh? Last time you brought it. And then you changed, you left them in the old, in the other jacket. It's my mistake. I'm sorry. It's British Airways mistake. Okay. I could have been one of the victims of BA-390 now. And become famous. 87 and 89, huh? Okay. Can someone here find us what is 87 and 89? Can someone have, yeah. If you have a mushaf, okay, here. Okay, the brother did his homework, alhamdulillah. Well, I will look at this later, but I want to see, because actually in Surah Al-Isra, I have some things that we mentioned some last time, but actually, there are also some verses that we did not discuss last time. But the dua of the Prophet, I will take this with me, okay? The dua of the Prophet was affected very significantly with the tarbiyah, spiritual tarbiyah done to him in the Quran. And you see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks a lot, expressing his helplessness, his weakness, his need for Allah. For example, the Prophet ﷺ makes this dua, Allahumma inni zalamtu nafsi zulman kathira wa la yaghfiru adh-dhunuba illa ant faghfir li maghfiratan min indika warhamni innaka antal ghafurur rahim. Allah, I indeed wronged myself a lot, and no one forgives sins except you, so grant forgiveness for me and be merciful to me, for you are the most forgiving, most merciful. Wa ana abduk ظلمت نفسي واعترفت بذنبي فاغفر لي ذنوبي جميعا إنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت واهدني لأحسن الأخلاق. You are my Lord, I am your slave servant, I wronged myself, I admit that I sinned, forgive all my sins, no one forgives sins except you. Guide me to the best of manners, for no one guides to it except you. Protect me from the bad manners, for no one protects from them except you. Here I come, O Allah, to please you. All the good is in your hands, while evil cannot reach you. No refuge from you except you. Helplessness. He's showing his helplessness. Allah, forgive my sin. Forgive my ignorance. Forgive my extravagance on my account. And everything that you know about me, which I may not know. To this extent, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is having fear of God. He is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who doesn't commit sins actually, and that's his psychological status because of the humbleness, because of the tarbiyah done to him in the Quran. Forgive what I do in times of seriousness. Oh Allah, forgive what I do in time of humor. Oh Allah, forgive my intentional mistakes and my unintentional mistakes. Oh Allah, what I bring forward and what I postpone. The mistakes that I bring forward and what I postpone. Oh Allah, forgive what I announce and what I keep secret. He says, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an adilla aw udal. This is when he goes out from his house. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an adilla aw udal. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from being self-misguided or misguided by others. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an azilla aw uzal. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from falling in sins or from being tricked by others to fall in a sin. أو أظلم أو أظلم, or from wronging others or being wronged by others. أو أجهل أو يجهل علي, or from harassing others or being harassed by others. The word يجهل here means to harass someone verbally. He says, رب اجعلني لك شكارا لك ذكارا لك رهابا لك مطيعا إليك مخبتا إليك أواها منيبا رب تقبل توبتي واغسل حوبتي وأجب دعوتي واهد قلبي وسدد لساني وثبت حجتي واسلل سخيمة قلبي. Lord, make me very grateful to you. Make me remember you all the time. Make me very fearful of you. Make me very obedient to you. Make me very submissive to you. Make me return back to you frequently. Accept my repentance. Respond to my dua. Guide my heart. Support my speech. Support me when I speak. Purify my heart. This is dua of someone who believes that personally he can do nothing. That everything comes from Allah. He's asking Allah to make him speak well, not just to forgive his sins. This is someone that was disciplined in a way that believes now that he can do nothing without Allah. And I told you last time that there is a verse in the Bible which I believe that it is one of the intact verses that were not changed, where Jesus is saying, out of my own self I can do nothing. And when I debate with Christians, I tell them, is this a tone of a God speaking or of a servant? A servant of Allah. The Prophet ﷺ says, Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O controller of the hearts, make my heart steadfast in your religion. He is the Prophet of Allah, not just a prophet. He was chosen to be the Prophet, one of the prophets, the elite of humanity. And then he was chosen to be among the messengers, more special than just a prophet, because not every prophet is a messenger. And then he was chosen to be among the best five messengers. And then he was chosen to be the final prophet and messenger. The elite of the elite of the elite of the elite. The most noble of the most noble of the most noble. And he's making dua that Allah makes his heart steadfast on the religion. See, to this extent, that's why Abu Hanifa used to tell his students, you fear sins, I fear kufr. The hearts are between the, are in Allah's hands. He can tell them however he wants. So you really have to be grateful to Allah that you are Muslim, that you come to pray. It's not something personal about you. It's Allah chose you to be among those who come to pray. You could have been now in a bar or a pub. Allah chose you to be among those, the stars. I told you before, well, the story of the stars, huh? Who are the stars? It's not Drake and ريحانة. No, those are not the stars. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, فضل العالم على العابد كفضل القمر على سائر الكواكب. The privilege of a scholar on a worshipper is like a full moon compared to a star. What does that mean? People focused on the importance of knowledge. But look at what it means. It means that the angels look from heavens at our planet to see a dark planet. And then they see the scholars as full moons and the worshippers like stars. The people who practice Tawheed are either moons or stars. So when I see the stars, I mean you guys. You are the stars. In a place where there is kufr and you are practicing Tawheed, you are the stars. Alhamdulillah. But Allah chose you to be the stars. Not the people who drink and take drugs and then people call them stars. SubhanAllah. In Surah Hud, what I want to speak about today actually, in Surah Hud there are some verses that showed how Allah disciplined Prophet Nuh. They are telling him, his people, we can see that you are nothing but a mortal like us. And it is clear to see that only the vilest among us follow you. We cannot see how you are any better than we are. In fact, we think you are a liar. And they said, Nuh, you have argued with us for too long. Bring down on us a punishment as you threaten us with, if you are telling the truth. And Nuh here wanted Allah to support him. Here at this point, Nuh, the last thing that he wants to hear is an order of building a boat in the desert, actually. What he really wants to hear is, I am supporting you now somehow. By guiding them or by destroying them or anything. But no, instead of this, Nuh was told, build an ark. This is bringing more problems actually. So what happened is, they started to be sarcastic. He's building an ark in the middle of the desert. And Nuh did not even argue. Did not even ask Allah why. Just build an ark. He built an ark. And they said, they laughed at him. The Quran says, and whenever leaders of his people passed by, they laughed at him. He said, you may scorn us now, but we will come to scorn you later. He had the trust in Allah, that Allah will not make of him a matter of fun. And it really happened. So he had this trust. But this did not happen all like that. Just by disciplining. Surah Al-Isra also. There are verses that I did not mention last time. Allah in verse number 74 says, وَلَوْلَا أَن ثَبَّتْنَاكَ لَقَدْ كِتَّ تَرْكَنُ إِلَيْهِمْ شَيْئًا قَلِيلًا إِذَا لَأَذَقْنَاكَ ضعف الحياة وضعف الممات ثم لا تجد لك علينا نصيرا وإن كادوا ليستفزونك من الأرض ليخرجوك منها وإذا لا يلبثون خلافك إلا قليلا سنة من قد أرسلنا قبلك من رسلنا ولا تجد لسنتنا تحويلا. You wrote those verses. I saw it. It says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in Surah Al-Isra, coming back from the journey of Al-Isra and Mi'raj, being so special like that. Allah tells him, if we had not made you stand firm, you would almost have inclined little towards them. Just little, towards the kuffar. Allah says, in that case, we would have made you taste a double punishment in this life and a double punishment after death. And then you would have found no one to help you against us. Wow. So hard, actually. Wallahi, when I read these verses, sometimes I feel like I'm sympathizing with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So hard, so difficult discipline. But the Quran is disciplining him. They planned to scare you off the land, but they would not have lasted for more than a little while after you. Such was our way with the messengers we sent before you, and you will find no change in our ways. Which means what's happening to you is not something special. It happened to all the messengers before you too. You're not the first one. Disciplining. Don't think yourself special. To discipline him, and he is special. Now let's talk about today's topic, which is spiritual jihad. A Syrian scholar called Sheikh Bouti says, being satisfied with your own self means that you are submitting to its wishes, and this can destroy the human being, and the first thing to destroy him is pride. Which means, if you are satisfied with yourself, this means that you are submitting to your desires. But I believe you are all here because you're not satisfied with yourselves. You want to discipline yourself better. But it's very dangerous when someone is satisfied with himself. And you see this a lot. People saying, Alhamdulillah, I'm okay. And I always pray on time. I never wrong people. I never backbite. And they're satisfied. He just mentions the things that, but he never tries to find his shortcomings. And this is so dangerous, brothers. The Quran orders us not to be satisfied with ourselves, and at the same time also not to praise ourselves. The Quran says in Surah Al-Najm, فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Do not assert your own goodness. He knows who is mindful of him. Also in Surah An-Nisa, the Quran says, have you considered those who claim purity for themselves? No. God purifies whoever he will. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ يُزَكُّونَ أَنفُسَهُمْ بَلِ اللَّهُ يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. How can we domesticate our soul? We have souls that are wild, full of pride, full of arrogance, and we want to domesticate it. Number one, do not trust your ego. Don't trust it. Don't trust your soul. I'll talk about everyone in details. Second, be cautious of it and what it can do to you. It can trap you. It can trick you. Third, to control an animal, to control a horse, there is something called the bridle. You bridle it, and then you can control it. There is a bridle that you can use for your soul, and this is the fear of God. Be fearful of God to bridle your soul. Fourth, resist the desire of becoming distinguished. We said this is the biggest desire in a human desire, which is to be distinguished than others in money, in wealth, in knowledge, in anything. You have to resist this, and we will come to this in details. Hold yourself accountable and repent continuously. First thing, don't trust your ego. Why? Because it never enjoins good. Your soul will never tell you to do something good, by the way. It will always push you toward the desires. Who tells you not to wake up for Fajr? Before you sleep, tells you, come on, don't set the alarm. It's your soul, the stingy soul. Why? Because the soul is stingy. Stingy with effort and stingy with money. Doesn't want you to spend and doesn't want you to make effort. Who whispers to you to look at the haram, to watch haram things? It's the soul. Pushes you towards the desires, lusts. So your soul whispers like the shaitan whispers exactly. And your soul is even more dangerous than the shaitan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا. Shaitan is weak. The shaitan whispers, click only when it is when it coincides with a whisper of the soul. So if the soul tells you, today I want this, a desire, one of the desires. At the same time, shaitan whispers the same. Now you can be too weak to resist this. But the soul is more dangerous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Qaf, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ وَنَعْلَمُ مَا تُوَسْوِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُ. We created man and we know what his soul whispers to him. He didn't say what the shaitan whispers to him. What his soul whispers to him. Also, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, speaking about the son of Adam who killed his brother. فَطَوَّعَتْ لَهُ نَفْسُهُ قَتْلَ أَخِيهِ. But his soul prompted him to kill his brother. He didn't say the shaitan. It was his soul. Because he felt what? Envy. Envious. That was a weakness, a spiritual weakness. As we said, the soul is stingy. There is a hadith. There's an ayah that says the same. In Surah Al-Hashr, وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. This ayah, by the way, speaks about the Ansar. And it says, those who are saved from their own soul's greed are truly successful. So if you are saved, if Allah saves you from the greed of the soul, you can be saved. But it's greedy. It's stingy. Doesn't want you to wake up for Fajr. But if you have a plane, you will wake up 3 hours earlier. And you will make it to the airport 2 hours earlier. But not for Fajr. It's a soul. There's a piece of, it's a poem said by Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Rawaha, one of the great companions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was in Ghazwat Mu'ata. It's the battle of Mu'ata. And the Prophet ﷺ assigned him to be the third leader if the two others before him die. And the two before him died. And then he was supposed to take the standard and lead the army. And then he felt a hesitation. He hesitated for a while. So he said, who is making him to hesitate now? His soul tells him, you are putting yourself in danger now. So he said, أقسمت يا نفسي لتنزلن لتنزلن أو لتكرهن. I swear, my soul, I swear that you have to submit. Either you submit or I will force you to. And the rest of the poem is very beautiful, but it's a poem speaking to his own soul, threatening his own soul. Let's talk about the bridle. The bridle of the fear of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. In Surah Al-Nazi'at. For anyone who feared the meeting with his Lord and restrained himself from base desires, paradise will be home. So you have to restrain yourself from the base desires. You have to control yourself. How? By God-fearing. How can I bring God-fearing to my heart? You have to go back to the first lecture in At-Tarbiyah Al-Imaniyah. It was called Death, Al-Mawt. It shows you how to remember death. And how to remember Al-Akhirah, the hereafter. You will stand up to be accountable. To be held accountable. And then either hell or paradise. One of the things that I want you to do, this homework, one of the things will be to buy your kafan. You know the kafan? Kafan, the two pieces of cloth where you would be wrapped when you die. Buy it and keep it in your wardrobe. You open every day in the morning, you see your kafan. You choose the shirt, and the trousers or the thawb, and you, but you see your kafan every day. You'll be wearing this one day. Buy it and keep it to remember death. You see it and you go. And then you see a scantily dressed woman, you won't look. Because you remember death. Remind yourself with death. Listen to preaching that softens the hearts. There are very nice preachers who say good speeches that softens the hearts. Today we had one of them, Brother Yasser Qadi. There are many, alhamdulillah. Listen to them that say things that softens the heart. Not go and listen to fiqh, because some people are addicted to fiqh. What is halal? What is haram? What is halal? What is haram? I'm not saying fiqh, of course, it's a branch of knowledge. But our religion is not that dry. It's not a list of do's and don'ts. So I want you to listen also, or more actually than fiqh, to listen not only to the halal and the haram, listen to what softens your hearts. Today we had an excellent khutbah. This brother, Brother Yasser Qadi, is an excellent speaker. Listen to him. And there are others also, but I don't remember the names. Someone who founded Al-Bayina, what's his name? Nu'man Ali Khan, yes. He has also very inspiring talks. Listen to them. So important to read the explanation of the 99 names of Allah. The names of Allah. And I suggest for you a scholar, he's a Syrian scholar called Sheikh Muhammad Ratib al-Nablusi. He has a website called www.nablusi.com. Nablusi, N-A-B-U, not O. Nablusi, N-A-B-U-L-S-I.com. He is one of the best explainers of the names of Allah. So go to his website and read the explanation of the names of Allah. Especially Al-Qayyum. Especially those names that deal directly with you in your life. Al-Muqeet. These names. Third, you need to resist the whispers of your soul. Your soul whispers you to do what? To be proud of yourself. Pride. Don't listen. Don't let it trick you. Do not submit to your soul when it invites you to be proud of yourself. Actually, refer every success story in your life to Allah. That without Him, you could have not done that. Not even pray, not even give charity without Allah. I told you last time that the song that the Sahaba used to sing when they were digging the trench was Allahumma lawla anta mahtadayna wala tasaddaqna wala sallayna. And the Prophet was singing it with them. He was saying atayna, atayna, atayna. And then they continue. It was like the chorus. It says, oh Allah, without you, we could have never prayed or be guided or even spend in charity. Without you, oh Allah. Everything good that you do, even in work, even being good with your children or your wife or your colleagues or baby, it's because of Allah. It's humbling yourself to Allah. Doesn't mean that you're bad, but it means that without Him, you are unplugged. No power. That's what I said, al-dhikr, remembrance of Allah. I tracked the word kathiran in the Quran 2 days ago. The word kathiran means a lot. And I found that it was never mentioned with any worship except al-dhikr. وَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا كَيْ نُسَبِّحَكَ كَثِيرًا وَنَذْكُرَكَ كَثِيرًا. Allah orders us to pray, orders us to fast, orders us to pay charity, but only a dhikr was mentioned to be done a lot, frequently. Why? Because this is the plug. With the remembrance of Allah, you're plugged and you have power. Without it, you don't have power. Hold yourself accountable. before you are held accountable. So you hold yourself accountable first before you are held accountable. Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, said, weigh your deeds before it is weighed for you. Your accountability tomorrow becomes easier if you hold yourself accountable today. So you should have a table. A table called the accountability table. Do it on your computer. Prayers. Of course, I'm not going to tell you, did you pray or not? This goes without saying. It is, did you pray jama'ah or not? If possible, in the mosque, this is the best. If not, and you're far from the mosque, then at least jama'ah with someone else. In your work or at home. So go and check. Fajr was jama'ah or not? Dhuhr was jama'ah or not? Asr was jama'ah or not? Maghrib, Isha, and so on. Did you pray the sunnah or not? By the way, there are so many hadith that talk about praying the sunnah will allow you to heaven. But be careful. You need to understand that. Sunnah should be done at home. It's not in the mosque. I'm shocking you now. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا تجعلوا بيوتكم قبورا. Don't let your houses be like tombs, like graves, where you go just to sleep. No, you should pray in your house. So the extra prayers should be done in the house. Of course, if you are doing i'tikaf, so if you come here to the mosque and you stay between two prayers, you can pray the sunnah, of course. But the issue is, basically, the sunnah should be done at home. So if you pray here and you're leaving, do the sunnah when you go back. You pray three rak'ahs in Maghrib here with us, and then you get up and you leave and you bear the looks in the eyes of the people. He's leaving without the sunnah. And you feel that your nafs is telling you, go back and pray, go back and pray. They're looking at you. Now you're not praying for Allah. You're praying for people. Yeah, pray the sunnah, all the sunnah. And try to do it secretly. Secretly, oh, at home at least. Did you recite the Quran for an hour today with tadabbur, with reflection? Did you reflect upon the Quran? Did you memorize an ayah or two? When you do tadabbur and when you reflect and ponder upon the verses of the Quran, you will memorize it. That's what the Sahaba did, by the way. They memorized as a result of tadabbur. Memorization was never the goal, never. The goal is to do tadabbur, and because of the tadabbur, they memorize. And then the manners. Did you backbite someone? If yes, write his name. Write her name. Sisters, you hear me, huh? Last time when I gave the homework of informing three people that you backbite and ask forgiveness from them, one of the sisters here, mashallah, she sent me, said, I informed six. Well, but we also do the same, I see. Did you backbite someone? Every day you should hold yourself accountable. Did you look at someone with arrogance? Because he's not well dressed, or because he looks poor, or because, yeah, your eyes, Allah gave it to you to look at people like that? Did you act arrogantly? Did you lower your gaze? Or did you look? Did you listen to bad stuff? People coming back biting others, did you listen to them? Or did you say, like Islam told you, I can't listen to this? Did you enjoin the good and forbid the evil? Al-amr bin ma'ruf wa nahy an munkar. Did you obey your parents? Did you listen to the advice of your teacher or your scholar? Did you do the homework of the spiritual purification workshop? Did you do the homework of the heart purification workshop, which is very important? And those who attended with us, you know that there's a daily homework to be done forever. Did you do some sports? إِنَّ لِجَسَدِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًا. Did you give charity today? Anything. They are collecting. Yesterday they were collecting for a mosque in Denmark. Drop £5. Drop even £1. In the States, I was volunteering in one of the mosques, and I was volunteering in the fundraiser committee. So of course, every week we're having a fundraiser. And I found that one of the great people, actually, Dr. Ahmed Al-Qadi, may Allah be merciful to him. He's actually the student of Sheikh Hassan Al-Banna. I found that every time I find a pledge from him for like $10, $10, $10, $10, $10, and then $1,000. And then back $10, $10, in every fundraiser, $10, $10, and then $1,000. So I went and I asked him, Dr. Ahmed, what's that? Either $10 or $1,000. He said, when you find me donating $1,000, it means that I was convinced with the endeavor, so I want to participate. When you find me donating only $10, it means I wasn't convinced, and I don't want to participate, but I'm not sure. Maybe this is right and my opinion is wrong. So I learned from Sheikh Hassan Al-Banna, don't leave one gateway of khair, of good, without going through it. Those are people who think. When he doesn't want to participate, $10. He wants, he puts money, real money. Did you do i'tikaf for about 1 hour or something? It's nice to come here between Maghrib and Isha, or between Asr and Maghrib, and do i'tikaf. When you enter the mosque, you say, Nawaitul i'tikaf. I have the intention of doing i'tikaf. I'tikaf is one of the great, great ways to worship Allah. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Ibrahim and his son Ismail, أن طهر بيتي للطائفين والعاكفين والركع السجود. Prepare my and clean my house, my sacred mosque, for the طائفين, those who do tawaf, circumambulating the Kaaba, and those who do i'tikaf, were mentioned before those who are praying. I'tikaf. You're sacrificing some time for Allah. You come to the mosque and you keep reading in the corner. Ihsa al-ni'am. Count the gifts of Allah. We spoke about that several times. And we said, how can we make ourselves remember the ni'mah and the gift of Allah? But here I loved this hadith mentioned about Prophet Musa. Imam Ahmad mentioned it in his book Az-Zuhd. It says, Moses worried about his Lord's right on him. First, before worrying about his deeds, and said, Lord, how can I thank you while the smallest gift you gave me weighs more than all my good deeds? Moses said, Ya Rabbi, kayfa li an ashkurak? وأصغر نعمة وضعتها عندي من نعمك لا يجازي بها عملي كله. Oh Lord, how can I thank you? How can I thank you? The smallest gift, all my deeds cannot pay for it. Jibreel came telling him, Allah tells you, يا موسى الآن شكرتني. Oh Moses, now you have thanked me. By knowing that you cannot thank me, you thanked me. It was also narrated in another narration by Al-Khara'iti in his book Fadilat al-Shukr. It says, قال موسى لربه يوم الطور أي ربي إن كلمتني فمن قبلك وإن صليت فمن قبلك وإن صمت فمن قبلك وإن أرسلتني فمن قبلك وإن بلغت رسالتك فمن قبلك فكيف أشكرك. Moses said it in Al-Tur mountain to Allah when he was speaking to Allah. Lord, speaking to me is a gift from you. My prayers are a gift from you. My fasting is a gift from you. Propagating the message and doing da'wah is a gift from you. How can I thank you? Allah said, Moses, now that you know that it is all from me, now you thanked me. To remember the ni'mah and remember that you cannot pay back. Remember. How can we do so? It is by knowing Allah and knowing ourselves. When you know Allah and knowing yourself, then you know your status. You know your status. Alhamdulillah. The one who, this is mentioned by Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah in his book Madarij al-Salikin. He says, the one who realizes the right of Allah on him and the importance of servitude to him will not see his good deeds as they will become so tiny. So when you know who is Allah and who are you, you will not see your good deeds. Your good deeds will become so tiny and you will realize that they are not enough to save you. Here there's a dilemma. What? Our good deeds will not save us? Yes, of course. Of course. Okay, then why do we do good deeds? Let's not do good deeds then, if they are not enough to save us. Why do we do good deeds? We do good deeds so that Allah looks at us with mercy. Which means, a beggar doesn't deserve the money that he gets from if someone who gives him a charity. He doesn't deserve the money. But what does this beggar do if this beggar is smart? He goes in front of the house of the rich man at the times that he knows that the rich man comes in or comes out. And he starts begging there. If he goes at 3 o'clock in the morning, or if he goes at 2 o'clock where the man... So he has to do some smart things in order to be given the charity, which he doesn't deserve, actually. He doesn't deserve it. Actually, by doing these things, you become more likely to be saved. You understand me? So what the good deeds that we do increases the opportunity that you become more likely to be treated with mercy. But not because your good deeds are enough. The Prophet ﷺ said so, by the way. لا يدخل أحدكم الجنة بعمله. None of you will be allowed into paradise because of his good deeds. They said, not even you, Prophet of Allah. He said, not even me. إلا أن يتغمدني الله برحمته. Except if Allah looks at me with mercy. Not even the good deeds of Prophet Muhammad. All this jihad, all this da'wah, all this effort, all this patience, he said, is not enough. But when we do all these good deeds, we become more likely to be treated with mercy. Tawbah, repentance, frequently repent. Why do people repent? When they see that they committed something, which means repentance is the result of a good accountability. If you hold yourself accountable, you will repent from things that you do. But when you find yourself, when you're very satisfied with yourself and you don't find any bad things that you do at all, then you don't need to repent then. So the issue is, that's not a good accountability. Then you're not looking for your shortcomings. Actually, you are looking for the good things to please yourself and be proud of yourself. So the closer you become to Allah, the more you feel guilty. And the greater the repentance will become. You feel more need to repent. And the stronger your fear from Allah will be. And the more you will be unsatisfied with yourself. Again, here Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah mentions, it is very important to understand who Allah is. Through what? Reading the explanation of His names and attributes. He says in Madarij al-Salikin, the one who sees the truth of the names and the attributes of Allah with his heart and his status becomes crystal clear for him, would definitely see that his deeds compared to the right of Allah on him are less than a grain of mustard compared to all the mountains of this world, no matter how many times they are multiplied. Humbleness. To domesticate yourself, you need to humble yourself. Humbleness is the opposite of pride. Pride is to see yourself great. So humbleness is to see yourself insignificant. To see yourself insignificant, not to pretend to be insignificant. This is more dangerous, actually. Many people are humble, but faked humbleness. That they use it to show off with it. And they keep asking, oh Allah, let them see that I'm humble. No, real humbleness is when you see yourself really insignificant. So the humbleness is a state of the heart. It is felt by the servant within himself, but it is reflected clearly on his conduct. So it is reflected in your conduct when you really feel it inside. Al-Hasan said, Al-Hasan here is Al-Hasan al-Basri. At-tawadu' an takhruj min manzilak wa la talqa musliman illa ra'ayta lahu 'alayka fadla. Humbleness is to walk out of your door and see every single Muslim you meet better than you. Even if he's not a religious one, you say, maybe his heart is more pure than mine. Who knows how his end will be and how my end will be. See, look at every Muslim around you. He's better than you. You need to serve him. You need to help him. You need to be better than you are. Don't be satisfied with yourself. Imam al-Shafi'i said, same meaning again. أَرْفَعُ النَّاسِ قَدْرًا مَنْ لَا يَرَى قَدْرَهُ وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ فَضْلًا مَنْ لَا يَرَى فَضْلَهُ. The highest in ranks among people is he who does not realize it. And the best of people is he who does not see the good which he has. And I mentioned before the example of this from the Quran. When Allah speaks about the Arians, I said the Arians are the true followers of Jesus, son of Mary, who rejected the Trinity and who rejected the divinity of Jesus, the true followers of Jesus. The verse says, لَتَجِدَنَّ أَشَدَّ النَّاسِ عَدَاوَةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الْيَهُودَ وَالَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا وَلَتَجِدَنَّ أَقْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ مِنْهُمْ قِسِّيسِينَ وَرُهْبَانًا وَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. You are sure to find the closest in affection towards the believers are those who say we are Christians, for there are among them priests and monks. These people, Allah says, are never arrogant. أَنَّهُمْ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. So they are never arrogant. And when they listen to what has been sent down to the messenger, when they listen to the Quran, you will see their eyes overflowing with tears because they recognize the truth in it. They say, our Lord, we believe, so count us among the witnesses. Why should we not believe in God and in the truth that has come down to us? When we long for our Lord to allow us, listen to this, when we long for our Lord to allow us in the company of the righteous. They want to be on the day of judgment in the company of the righteous. They don't look at themselves as righteous. They don't even have hope to be righteous. All they want is that Allah enters them to paradise with the righteous. See how humble. Who are those people before Allah? Allah says, for saying this, God has rewarded them with gardens graced with flowing streams, and there they will stay. That is the reward of those who practice ihsan. وَذَلِكَ جَزَاءُ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Actually, they are the highest. They are those who are practicing ihsan. Not iman, not Islam, It's Islam, Iman, and then Ihsan. Those are the highest. But they see themselves the worst. Humble, really humble. Believe inside that they do not deserve. Humbleness is what? An obligation. That's another shock. In the beginning I told you, to be optimistic is an obligation, and I give you the evidence. Humbleness is also an obligation. Evidence. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَوْحَى إِلَيَّ أَن تَوَاضَعُوا حَتَّى لَا يَفْخَرَ أَحَدٌ عَلَى أَحَدٌ وَلَا يَبْغِي أَحَدٌ عَلَى أَحَدٌ. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, Allah revealed to me that you should humble yourselves until none brags the other or wrong the other. It's a command. Prophet Muhammad is musharri'. He gives sharia. This is a command. But we said, the most dangerous type of pride is the faked humbleness. The pretended humbleness. It is the most dangerous type of arrogance. Real humbleness is to see yourself insignificant. Not to pretend to be insignificant. Pretending to be humble is a bigger ground for pride to grow. Actually, the biggest. That's why before humbling yourself, you have to plant the seed of knowing your Lord and knowing yourself. Then humbleness will come later. When you water it, it will grow. But you need to know your Lord. That's why I'm telling you, reading the names of Allah and its meanings is so important to really make you humble. To know yourself, to know your status, to know your real rank. Some of the examples of humbleness that shows how, for example, Prophet Muhammad showed his need for Allah and his weakness and his helplessness. He enters Mecca. In Fath Mecca, the greatest victory, and he enters like a defeated person. His chin was actually about to touch the neck of his ride. Like that. He enters like that. Like a defeated person, not like a conqueror. Humbling himself to Allah. Why? Because this victory is from Allah, not from him. Not from the Sahaba. And Najashi, Negus, the king of Abyssinia, when he heard the news that the Muslims were victorious in Badr, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib came and saw him wearing rags and sitting on the ground in the dust. This is a king of one of the biggest kingdoms. So he told him, why are you doing so? He said, one of the teachings of Jesus, son of Mary, peace be upon him, إِنَّ حَقًّا عَلَىٰ عِبَادِ اللَّهِ أَن يُحْدِثُوا لِلَّهِ تَوَاضُعًا عِنْدَمَا يُحْدِثُ لَهُمُ النِّعْمَةِ. It means, it is a duty that people should humble themselves to Allah when Allah gives them a gift. And when I heard the news that Allah gave victory to the Prophet and the Sahaba in Badr, I felt like I have to humble myself to Allah. This is a king of one of the greatest kingdoms. He wore rags and he sat on the ground, on the dust, humbling himself. Umar ibn al-Khattab went to enter Jerusalem. Jerusalem was conquered, it was opened, and the Sahaba said, come to take the keys of the city from the monks. The monks said, we're not going to give you the keys. There's someone that we know that in our books, it is his attributes are written, his characteristics we know it. So they sent, and Umar came from Medina. Umar and his ghulam, his assistant, they were actually sharing one ride. So when they were about to enter Jerusalem, it was the turn of the boy to ride and Umar to walk. So the boy said, well, let me walk and you be riding because we cannot enter Jerusalem like that. He said, no, come here, take your turn. So Umar was actually dragging the camel, and the boy is on the camel. And then he came across a muddy puddle. So Umar took off his shoes and put it under his armpits, and he went through the muddy puddle, pulling the camel like that. And of course, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah saw this. He ran quickly and said, Umar, the elite of Jerusalem are waiting. Please, I don't want them to see you like that. He said, look, Abu Ubaidah, Allah honored us with Islam, so I don't care with people and what people say. If he's honored with Islam, not with the fancy clothes, not with the fancy car, with Islam. And the one who humbles himself to Allah, Allah raises his ranks. So when you are tested with a promotion, when you become promoted in your work, when you become promoted in an organization and become the leader of one of the Muslim organizations or any organization, something like that, humble yourself. Humble yourself more. When Allah tests you with a promotion or being in a leadership position, your ego would like to inflate and grow and replace servitude with pride and arrogance. So be careful here. People, they say people change when they are promoted. We see people, they are very high, nice and humble, but as soon as they get a promotion, they become different. What happens to them? The ego inflates. They feel that they are more important now. Yeah, we were less important like you, but now we're more important than you. Oh. SubhanAllah. So actually, what do you do here when you are promoted? You exaggerate in humbling yourself. Not pretend, but you do more humbleness. You do more humbleness to remind your soul with its real status, with its real rank. Abu Bakr Siddiq used to milk the goats for his neighbors. Looks like he had some widows who are neighbors, old people. So he used to go and milk their goats and take the milk to them. And then he became the Khalifa. What did he do? He kept going every day to milk the goats for his neighbors. That's it. The Prophet ﷺ actually used to milk the goat for his wives. You know how do you milk a goat? The goat is that high. Of course, he's not going to put the goat on a table and milk the goat. No, he goes on his knees and he milks the goats. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Umar, when he was the Khalifa, at the day of Eid, he went on the minbar wearing rags, barefooted, and he said, I remember when I was young, I used to take care of some goats that belonged to my aunts, and they would pay me every day a handful of dates. And then he went down and left. What's his name? Who was so wealthy among the Sahaba? No, Ghifari was so poor. Abdurrahman ibn Auf took his hand and he said, what did you do to yourself? Ma araka illa an qama'ta nafsak. I saw that you only humiliated yourself. He said, leave me, Abdurrahman, you don't know what happened to me today. I woke up in the morning and my soul whispered to me, you are the Amir. I said, okay, I'll show you what I will do to you today. That's what you're trying to do to me? Tell me I'm the Amir? I'm the leader of all those people? Okay, I'll show you. And that he did what he did. He's disciplining himself, disciplining his soul, reminding himself that he's not better than anyone. There's someone else, actually, an example of humbleness. He is called Dr. Morsi. He was the first elected president of Egypt. When he was elected, the first day as a president, his personal guards found that he's leaving the house at 4 o'clock in the morning. Where are you going? He said, to pray Fajr. Huh? Okay, pray at home? He said, no, I'm going to go to the mosque. Okay, so the guards went with him to the mosque. He prayed with the people. He left the mosque and he went in the opposite direction. They said, where are you going? He said, I am used to buy fresh toast every day for the family. They said, look, this will not happen again. From now on, we will bring you the toast. This is the president of Egypt. You pray Fajr in the mosque, okay. And then you want to go and stand up in the line with the people to buy fresh bread. This is Dr. Morsi. Today he's in jail. Trying him for high treason. Criminals are doing this to him. Khawarij are doing this to him. But he's an example. And inshallah, Allah will give him victory, make him victorious inshallah. Inshallah. Make dua for him. And to all of them. Just last week, four great scholars, got a sentence, a death sentence. And this increases the number of death sentences now to 1,300 so far. When you are granted a gift, when you don't do something successful, when you score a goal, go make sujood. Have you seen the Algerians doing sujood? Alhamdulillah. I had a haircut with an Algerian barber actually. Ah, alhamdulillah. He finished before the Belgian. But I have seen what happened to another person actually. But actually here, this is very important. When something like that happens, you make sujood to remind yourself that success comes from Allah. Success comes from Allah. Of course, not because you make sujood, Allah will make you a winner. No. Allah will make you a winner when you train more. But the sujood brings barakah, for sure. Being humble is very important for your own self. In your dua, show this humbleness to Allah. You saw the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Use these things. Like when he says, أنا البائس الفقير المستغيث المستجير المقر المعترف بذنبه. I am poor, I am miserable, I'm begging for help, seeking refuge, scared, afraid, admitting my sins. I ask you, Allah, like a poor person, like a humble sinner. I ask you, like a scared, blind man whom his neck is subdued to you, and his eyes are filled up with tears, and his body surrendered, and his nose is put down on the ground for you. Humble yourself to Allah like that. Don't just, oh Allah, give me £1 million. Oh Allah, I need to change my car. No. You need to speak to Allah first and to humble yourself to Allah. Tell him, I need you. I need you. I need your help. I am helpless. I'm weak. Without you, I am nothing. Do this. Like that, you are actually elevating your status with Allah. Humbleness at time of calamity. When you are afflicted with a calamity, maybe this is, Allah is waking you up. Maybe it's a wake-up call for you. That's what Allah said in Surah As-Sajdah, verse number 21. وَلَنُذِيقَنَّهُمْ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَدْنَى دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. We shall certainly make them taste a nearer torment in this life prior to the greater torment, so that perhaps they may return to the right path. So maybe Allah afflicts you with some torment in this life, so that you avoid the torment in the other life. To wake up. A wake-up call. وَلَقَدْ أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بِالْعَذَابِ فَمَا اسْتَكَانُوا لِرَبِّهِمْ وَمَا يَتَضَرَّعُونَ. We have already afflicted them, yet they did not submit to their Lord. They will not humble themselves. Which means Allah afflicted them with the adab, with torment, so that they may be awake. And still they didn't. They did not wake up. But Allah said, He did so to make them submit, but their nafs was stronger. Many examples of humbleness. Prophet Musa is a great example of humbleness from among the messengers. يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى told him, I am making you a messenger. I chose you to be a messenger. And then he said, my brother Aaron is more eloquent than I. Send him with me to help me and confirm my words. I fear they may call me a liar. He saw himself smaller and not qualified enough, even though he showed, yeah, and he did a perfect job. He really did a perfect job as a messenger. But he didn't see himself like that. He saw that the responsibility is bigger than him. He wanted more. He wanted help. SubhanAllah. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told by Jibreel, choose. There are two types of prophets. Kings like Solomon and David and prophets, or servants and prophets. He chose to be a servant and a prophet. So Jibreel told him, in return of your humbleness, Allah have made you the master of the sons of Adam on the day of judgment, and the first one whom the earth will open for him to resurrect, and the first intercessor. He chose to be a servant. He could have said, well, a prophet and a king. Why not? A servant. One of the examples of his humbleness also, when he said, may Allah be merciful to my brother Joseph. Had the messenger of the king come to release me from jail, I could have rushed out. But Joseph said, go back to your Lord and ask him about the women who cut their hands. The king sent a messenger telling Joseph, you're out from jail. The king have pardoned you. He said, go back to him and reopen the investigation again. He did not go out with a pardon. He wanted to go out as an innocent person. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, had this happened to me, I could have went with them. Of course, the Prophet is no way less in courage or nobility than Joseph, but he's humbling himself. He speaks like that about himself. Someone comes to him and says, O Prophet of Allah, who's the most noble person? He said, Joseph. Why? He said, Huwa al-Kareem ibn al-Kareem ibn al-Kareem ibn al-Kareem. He is the noble, the son of the noble, the son of the noble, the son of the noble. Why? Because he is a prophet, and his father Jacob is a prophet, and his father Isaac is a prophet, and his father Abraham is a prophet. He even thought about himself. Humble. Lady Aisha sees him sitting on the floor, putting his food on the floor, eating like that. She said, by Allah, please, I want to bring you a cushion and you lie back and you eat comfortably. He said, oh, Aisha, I am just a servant. I sit like a slave and I eat like a slave. I'm a slave servant of Allah. Humble, humble himself. Khalifa Abu Bakr. He became a Khalifa, and in his speech he said what? يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ لَقَدْ وُلِّيتُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَسْتُ بِخَيْرِكُمْ. O people, I became in charge while I am not the best among you. Actually, he was the best among them. But he doesn't see himself like that. He's not lying. But he doesn't see himself like the best at all. Sit with the poor people. Eat with the poor people. Doing this will really affect you spiritually very positively when you do that. Do things because that show that you humble yourself to your brothers. I don't know about how. Yani in Egypt there are things that we say to people here. I can't tell you go and take buses yet. Buses are normal here, yeah. Everybody takes buses, yeah. But in Egypt, buses are different, yeah. I don't know what to do here, but maybe clean the shoes of the people outside. Do something, I don't know. But do humble yourself to people. You have to humble yourself to people. If you are living with roommates, serve them. If they eat and leave the plates, wash them. Wash their plates. Clean. If you're cleaning your shoes, take the shoes of your roommates and clean it for them. Why not? Go and then you will wash your hands later, inshallah. But humble yourself to people, Muslims. You have to. If you have people who are less fortunate people, poor people, invite them to eat with you on your table. Don't leave this in ranks. There are people who eat in the kitchen. There are people who eat in the... Many houses are like that, by the way. Many houses are like that. Eat with them in the kitchen. Bring them to your table and eat with them on the table. What's the difference between you? Who knows who's better? Actually, who is better? You or them? Them. Always take this into consideration. They are probably better. Put this in mind, Damon. So Allah said, وَخْفِدْ جَنَاحَكَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Lower your wings over the believers. Which means humble yourself for the believers. Anas narrated that any slave girl in Medina could take the Prophet anywhere to do her any favor she wants. He wouldn't say, okay, I'll bring someone with you to do. No, if she wants anything, hadir, he goes with her. He does whatever she wants. He tells people to do this. He intercedes for people. Anas also said, Anas was the assistant to Prophet Muhammad. He used to serve him. He said, he used to ride with me on the same ride. And he used to put his food on the floor. And he used to respond or accept the invitation of a slave. So a very poor person, the poorest person, if he invites him to eat with him, he goes and he eats. When a poor person invites you to eat, you are not expecting the best food. But he goes for him, to please him. And he used to ride on donkeys. The elite don't ride donkeys. They ride camels or horses. Middle class, mules. Poor people, donkeys. He said Prophet Muhammad used to ride donkeys. Help people in their daily life activities. Umar ibn Khattab, the Khalifa, he saw a woman making porridge. He said, what are you doing? It's not done like that. Let me show you. He took the spoon and he said, look, you keep stirring and you put the water little by little while stirring. The Khalifa, Umar ibn Khattab. He's passing with all the Sahaba, and then he saw a woman doing the porridge, but not perfectly. He said, wait a minute. He went and he showed her how to do the porridge. Don't brag at all. Some people go and they say, excuse me, do you know who am I? Don't you know? Okay. Maybe you haven't been to Egypt. Everybody there knows me. And they speak, you don't know? Don't you know? If you're a dignitary, if you're a famous person and people don't know you, thank Allah for this. Don't go and keep telling. By the way, I'm very well known in other places. This is the ego. It inflates, and when it's inflated, it becomes an idol and people worship themselves. Mention your shortcomings. Say, one of my shortcomings is that I'm stubborn. Sometimes I'm too rushy. Sometimes I don't really think well. I just do things and I mess things. Yeah. Mention your shortcomings. Because usually you're mentioning only the good things about you. So mention your shortcomings, your mistakes, your stupidity, your failure. When was the last time you said, I tried to do this but I failed? People never say so. As if we never fail. But we see the failure around us, but in ourselves never. Don't be ashamed of saying that you do not know. When someone tells you something, say, I don't know. Because many of us hate to say, I don't know. If you're asked about something and you don't know, just come up with something. And this can hurt, by the way. Can hurt. Listen well to people. Try. Well, among the homework also. Sit with people and don't speak at all. Keep listening to them. Listen. You think it's easy? You will feel like you want to interrupt and give your opinion and show your wisdom. And it's hard. So what to do? Sit and listen only for an hour listening. And you don't talk at all. Try it. This is among you in your homework, by the way. I feel pity for the sisters. When you're at home, you talk to your wife, okay? And the sister will do jihad and not talk to you, actually. So both of you have to do the jihad now here. A man was speaking and someone else interrupted him. So Ata ibn Abi Rabah, one of the Sahaba, was still alive. And he saw that and he left and he was so angry. He said, what are those manners? Just because someone interrupted someone else. What are those manners? Oh, I swear by Allah that one of us, the Sahaba, used to hear from people things that he already knows. And maybe the same person told me the same thing before. And we just leave him to continue and we don't tell him that he told us this before. We don't interrupt people. Let them speak. Don't show that you're knowledgeable. Don't show that. Actually, I have here a picture. You all know it. The recent Pope now, the Pope of the Catholics, washing the feet of people, kissing their feet. Look at this. Why did he do this? Why is he doing this? Showing humbleness, of course, but actually it's one of the teachings of Jesus. Jesus, son of Mary, washed the feet of his own Sahaba. Wash your brother's feet. Yeah, let's do that together, by the way. Now we can go to the wudu place, okay? Every one of us now, choose one of your brothers and go and wash his feet. Why not? After you wash it, it's clean, kiss it. Is it so hard? Humble yourself. You need to destroy this ego. You need to destroy the ego. I'm not telling you to go and kiss other people's feet outside in the street, but I'm telling you, your brother, your Muslim brother, take him, wash his feet, it's clean, alhamdulillah, kiss it, what's wrong? You need to do something, I'm telling you. If we were in Egypt, I could have just told you, take the bus. But I can't tell you, take the bus here, take 25 to Ilford. Actually, talk about the wajib, the homework, inshallah. You will buy your kafan and put it in your wardrobe with your clothes, with your dresses, with your abaya, sister. Okay? You see it every day. You remember death. Pray sunnah as much as possible at home. So if you leave and go home, then pray it there. But if you're staying in the mosque, don't waste the sunnah. Pray it in the mosque. Okay? Go out with your friends and listen to them and don't talk. Just listen. Try to go against your own self. Okay? Do an action that humbles yourself to others. Somehow, I gave you several examples. Now let's take questions. Yes, yeah. How, of course, when men do housework, actually, this should be the norm, actually. I don't know if you know this or not. In Islam, cleaning and cooking is not the responsibility of the woman. This is fiqh. Ladies now are very happy. But I want to tell you that you don't really want to eat their cooking. Okay? But yes, of course, when you do things at home, this also can help, of course. If your culture is against it, if your culture looks at the man who works at home and cleans at home, downgrades it, so it will help you. But if this is normal in your culture, then it won't help you. You have to do something else. For example, in Egypt, we tell people, take something and clean in front of your home, clean the street in front of your home. So this humbles people in this place. Anyway.